Whole room.
What the heck? What is showing?
I think it goes to the next guy, look away.
No, it's not.
Yeah, it goes away.
Oh, okay. Good. All right. How's it going, everyone? My name is Louis. I work on a little bit on decentralized stuff about 2 years ago. Working a bit on some of the projects I work on, including a browser protocol that allows you to access decentralized network called HyperProxy. It's down now because Stefan cannot host it anymore.
Wait,
you know,
so.
Huh?
What? Crap.
Yeah. You destroyed the droplet. But anyway, so that's my background. I do know a little bit about. I've been reading a paper on that protocol about a year ago, and then we went through a bunch of, working on some sort of project on top of those protocol, the central protocol. And I'm also pretty, not too active, but I do dabble and try to do as many social media there as possible, because, try to diverse my portfolio with social media, besides just Twitter and Facebook, so the main topic of this talk is next generation social media, and how are we gonna join them? Well, how join them, right? Speaking of a slide. Anyway, so the first thing though, before we do any social media, is messaging. Everyone here probably using Discord, Slack, something like that. Well, you probably heard of IRC because all of you IRC kids probably know IRC. What is it? So you have the tie-in, which is Kiwi IRC. We're recommending it. Kiwi. The interface is pretty okay, and you can use it on the web. If you want to host your own server, it's under IRC. Get it, host your own server. Right, the pros, you can get your own server, and everyone can join. It's super fast, because it's a text, no caching. I mean, if you want to, you can set up your server to cache stuff, but, well, what's the point of it? The con is, the FBI is probably monitoring you, so get it, better be careful what you say up there. And there's no encryption, right? It's IRC, everything in plain text, because, it's easier to see and stuff. But, yeah, for basic communication, IRC is totally fine. And even I think the Linux group at RIT probably use that. Gridlock. And then the next version of IRC now that we have seen is Riot, or the Matrix protocol. And what is it? Well, it's basically a protocol that does decentralized chat. Not decentralized, that's my bad. It should be distributed chat. Because it has a client, it has a server. The server is now called Modular now, and you can get that. You can set up your own server called Modular, and you can now have your own Matrix server that you can have other people join. And it has encryption, so you can totally DM other people and not worry about having the NSA spying you. You also have a history cache, so it actually has a giant caching layer on top of itself. So a lot of people have deployed the Matrix, the protocol Matrix, on top of IRC so that it can cache and grab the history of the IRC. So you can actually use Matrix to join IRC channel in order to have a persistent cache of the IRC. So yeah, I use it a lot because, I don't want to have my IRC client run 24 hours to persist the history. So Matrix is like an awesome solution for that, at least from my end. You can actually, Kiwi actually persist some history, I think, but probably not a lot. And then, the main con is it's very slow. When you join an IRC, or when you join any channel at all, it's going to try to synchronize the history of that channel. So it's going to take quite a while, and especially if you are going to, if the channel is encrypted, or if you chat with someone else, it's encrypted. And for example, you're trying to join from a different device, that device will now have to synchronize the key from the Matrix server or from the Modular server and try to grab, try to synchronize and authorizing that your account on the two keys so that your new device can join the same conversation. And when you do that, it has to go through every single private kind of message and try to decrypt them. So it's super slow on that. And the main problem that I have this is maintenance of the server. So if you set up a Modular server, right? You probably have maybe one or two guys in the bedroom trying to maintain a server and have someone else join them for fun and profit, maybe. But you have to maintain it. A lot of people have to maintain their own server if they want to have something. So It is good. It is very good. It is very awesome. You should use it. But there's a cost maintenance there, right? So anyone can basically, if anyone know who is the guy who's hosting this Matrix server, right? He can tell the launch a DDoS server, DDoS on that to censor maybe some guy, some group that happened to host, you know, the channel on top of that server. Never know, but it's a cost. Now let's move on to the next generation of social media. We have microblogging. So what is microblogging? Twitter, right? Text something and send online. Everyone read it. So Twitter is a huge example for centralized type of infrastructure for the social media. But then we have Mastodon. So Mastodon is kind of a distributed Twitter. And by that, I mean, right, it has all the features of a Twitter. You can post stuff on top of the Mastodon network, and everyone will see that. And it's just, you know, a blob of text with maybe some images with a limited amount of text. So it's literally Twitter on top of the distributed network. The cool thing about Mastodon, right, is you can, you know, visit a DIY server. So you can set up your own Mastodon server and have other people join your server. And then, by the nature of Mastodon, using a concept called federated server, you can actually join other people's server using the account that you have on a certain server. So for example, if I set up a server called server A, and if I set up a server B, and I have an account on my server called, you know, like lab or server A, and Stefan has an account, Stefan on server B, I can actually use lab or server A to join Stefan's server without having to make another account on top of the server, because these two servers are federated. So they adhere to the server structure adhere to the same kind of like authorization protocol, so that the user from one server can actually join another server and talk on that server, and they can intercommunication. So it's pretty interesting. But what's the cost? The cost is still that. The server maintenance is still fucked. You still have to maintain the server, and this actually happened. There's a problem happened recently with one of the network that is focused on like SafeWalker. So there was a Mastodon server that focused on for SafeWalker and all the activists on the live stream SafeWalk. And a botnet was launched on that server. And they were down for, you know, for quite a while, and because there's only three people hosting a server, right? nobody can help them. And the server went down, and they had to, you know, wait until the bot stopped to run it down, back it up.
So I want to go back to the federated stuff. So if I have an account, are you going to talk about it now? Or?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, just,
yes.
Yeah.
So the federated stuff is called Fediverse. What's it mean? It's basically federated universe. And by that, so Mastodon implemented a thing, and it called something. Hey, Hector, can you remind me of that?
Activity token.
Thank you. So yeah, it's basically the protocol that allows you to share activity on top of all of these networks. And so a user that's registered on top of one of the server that implement the same, you know, like protocol, right? Then they are allowed to, because the protocol is the same, so the message structure should be similar, to allow that person or the account itself to be able to transfer and communicate on top of the server that implement the same infrastructure.
It's kind of like, if you think of it like email.
It's precisely email.
The email protocol, right, can be used by different software implementations. And ActivityPub is essentially the protocol for distributed social media.
So like, server A doesn't know your post on server B. It just knows how, like, that you are you.
Well, so you have to know that.
No, it
will know there's a server B, because when you join it, it will actually try to talk to the server B so that it can get information from you.
Oh, so server
that
A
way,
is talking to server B to
yes.
get your previous
They
posts.
Have real-time updates. Like, it'll send activities to your inbox.
Who
so
does, though?
The server.
So
what's
if
the
you,
server?
So, okay, so you have, let's say that you have server, okay, mastodon.com, and it wants to talk to mastodon.net, and you have user A on mastodon.com and user B on mastodon.net. User A will follow user B, meaning that they send a message to mastodon.net saying, I want to subscribe to their feed, kind of like an RSS feed, you know, almost. And then, so anytime user B posts a new status, Mastodon.net will federate that status by sending it to the inbox of user B. It'll just communicate from the server, and this all happens in real time.
Wait, but like, so is there like always some socket connection to that server?
Not necessarily.
Is it like polling, or is
it open? It's open fairly often. They just,
okay, the server communicate each other.
It doesn't really matter. The servers just communicate with each other. They ping each other whenever they have updates.
I'll come back to this later. So I will talk more about infrastructure of that, which is tightly connected to the servers and the infrastructure. But let's move on. So the next one is Fernica, which is distributed Facebook. It has all the functionality of a Facebook type of social media, where you can, you know, post a longer post, post picture, and visit a longer post for map blocking.
It's a really bad.
Has the exact same problem with Mastodon, basically.
Has a really bad name.
Oh, Fernica? Yeah. It's actually friendly.ca. The server, the project is at is in Canada, probably. I don't know, but there's a lot of German people on top of this network. The funny thing about this network, though, is a lot of people on here. So, probably you can see some interesting stuff. A lot of hippies.
Hippies.
People who literally post stuff about, like, I don't know.
Okay.
So there's a guy who was like doing like farming shit, and he decided to go to Brazil and, you know, with his entire family and abandon everything and sleep on the farm, and he updated on his friend's age. And he hosts a server there too, and it's like, damn, this guy's crazy. But it's cool though, he posts about everything, everyday life, right? He's like, oh shit, today I'm farming some shit. I'm like, wow, you're farming shit, huh? That's pretty cool actually. And then he actually invited people, you know, who might be interested to join from San Fran or whatever, to come join his family for whatever, you know. Maybe he went to do some farming, sure. Because the guy bought a huge block of land, you know, for to enjoy his land. Yeah, good for him. So yeah, there's a lot of interesting people on this, on top of the social media thing. You find the same, actually, yeah, Fernica seems to be a huge community of people who do, like, about to retire, and then they don't want to, they're trying to segregate from the, you know, from the noisy world, so, you know, and Facebook too noisy for them, so they decided to choose a social media that a little bit quiet, but they can also, you know, spread the word. So that's kind of the vibe I felt with Fernica. And a lot of German people are on Fernica. A lot of German server. That's what I noticed too. On Mastodon, the main demographic that I found is definitely a lot of artistic people, artists. Probably one of the main reasons why people who are into, like the biggest server is like the SafeWorker server, I think, or the third one, the third biggest. And then besides that, like programmer, and then yeah, mainly people who are into like all of that entertainment stuff.
According to my experience, the main demographic of Mastodon is now queer furry communists.
Yep. Queer left wing.
What?
Communists.
Yes.
Yep. Anyway,
sounds
when
like
you say furry,
way.
You're referring to like furry for like. Anyway, go back to the main problem. So, before I dive deeper into distributed and decentralized, I would like to use current terminology to make it more simpler. I found this analogy very helpful when I think about distributed versus decentralized. So, because you know, everyone kind of uses Torrent, and if you've ever used Torrent, you probably might understand this concept. So, if we have A, he's a leecher, gonna be A. You have B, who is the guy who uploaded the file originally, and you have C, he's a seeder. So the flow is B has a file and he shares it to everyone on the online on Torrent, and C happened to find B on a treasure, some VHE tracker, right? Any Torrent tracker out there, and he downloads the file from B. And then once C downloads the file, he now has the entire file and he decided, okay, I will also contribute to the community. So he decided to seed the file. So he's also now another uploader in this pool of people who are uploading the file. And then A come over and he said, okay, here's the file, I want to download it. Let's download it. So the guy just downloaded the two files from, you know, the pool, which is, you know, could come from B, could come from C. And once A done downloading though, the guy did something that very bad. He just cut off the connection. And he decided to not seed it. And basically, you know, people say he's a leecher. Or another word is an asshole, because he didn't contribute anything to the community and he just take the file and run away. So yeah, basically that's basically the kind of the terminology that I want to establish here. So don't be a leecher in a Torrent kind of a network. Because people will ban you trying to probably ban your IP if you are if there are too many leeches in the same part of the same IP.
Yeah.
So you might ruin your entire house from torrenting if you leech too much. So be warned. Because the tracker actually track it. A lot of VPN these days don't really let you to do torrenting now. Only some server in Canada maybe, in Belgium or Hong Kong maybe. But
isn't it supposed to be like they keep track of a ratio of downloaded to uploaded?
Yep.
And so then if the ratio was less than one, then you're a leecher, but if it's greater than one, then you're a seeder.
Yeah, because eventually, even if you download, if you don't have a little bit, right? I think even every sort of client now also upload a little bit.
So if you have just absolutely zero upload, then it's pretty bad. But like if you have, you know, like 0.5 or whatever ratio, then it's still not considered terrible.
Yeah, well, you do want to reach about, right? So the ratio is, you know, 0 to 1. So you want to say about 0.5 probably.
No, the ratio can be any rational, it can be any value.
No, talk about the ratio between leech and download, right? Or seed.
I mean,
because
like an individual user, if they download 10 gigabytes and then people download 20 gigabytes from them,
oh yeah,
the ratio of 2.
They do.
But you mean like the proportion of seeders to leechers?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
How do we make a tracker?
Oh, how you host a tracker?
Yeah.
You literally just download, I think it should be a torrent server, or the tracker server infrastructure.
Oh.
I have not dived into that. But it should be open source. So yeah, grab that, set up a server, and now you can basically become a tracker that everyone can use to track a certain peer and whatnot.
So how do people just trust a certain tracker?
Repeat the question.
When determining if like a leecher is, or determining leechers and seeders,
uh-huh.
People just trust a certain tracker is not lying about it?
Well, yeah, because the tracker has a lot of peer. So if the tracker lies, it will lie to everyone, then,
yeah.
You know, if the structure will, if it lies, then there's no point for it to lie, because it's a decentralized, it's a distributed network.
It doesn't gain much from lying.
Yeah, it doesn't really gain anything, because
there were, like, honeypot trackers for a while.
Yeah.
What is
yeah.
that?
Like the government would set up a tracker to
who's using it.
Right.
Yeah,
but
you don't want to do that.
Got too much
okay,
out
so
of
what does this apply
yeah.
to?
So we set up the terminology to talk about distributed. So here's a VPN link for you to agree and whatnot. So into a distributed network, I think of them as torrent remote leecher and seeder. That's kind of like when I think about that. And the reason why, because, so let's say A, B, and C are a seeder, or the people who host in the lab, right? They basically the hoster, or, you know, in Fediverse, they are the server that's hosting the server for people to use. And then B, E, and F are the client, or the user of that specific network of, you know, of Mastodon or Pernica. So E join A, E join B, and F join C. So it's a bond to answer your previous question, in general, like, so, A, B, and C are communicating with each other, and they are the main server. They are basically the powerhouse of this system, where they host the data that they need. And D, that's joined A, can now actually talk to F, you know, by talking to A and, you know, the A server, synchronized with C, so that F can now see stuff from D, if F or D.
So, like, D, the initial, like, entrance to this network was with A, so
yeah.
Now A will always be its like first, like its server that
yeah,
it
hosts. Yeah.
But then how does,
because A, B, and C are connected.
Right. Well, like A could just lie.
Well, it's a server though. It could lie. Technically, yes. It could. Yeah. That's true though. The government can literally, you know, can literally attack A, B, and C because they're the server, right?
And then if you have a graph of nodes, like, and you have like edges here, like, and you control all of those, now you've like basically lied
yes.
to the whole network on the left, right? Like,
yes, you will actually lie everything. So every server, if for example A is compliant, and there's a bunch of users in A, right?
Yeah.
And then for example E supplies to D, for example, and A suddenly got compromised, and someone, you know, managed to get a hold of A and tweak every single data. I hope that's not an encryption. I have not looked too deep into protocol yet.
Is the graph like fully connected? Like every node has to. Okay, so yeah.
No, only DB and C are connected because
okay.
They are the host. DE and every client, they have the router. So.
That really should be.
But yeah. If these compromise all the entire agent is compromised, and you see anything or who sees wrong stuff from the or from any from
anything.
So that's why, you know, it's actually possible to censorship to a split censorship in a sample branch. Because you can literally, if you know the server, you can launch a DDoS attack on any of the server and basically disable it. So nobody can now read stuff from it. So you technically censor it now. So
how do they discover each other?
Yeah, each of these
ABC.
So ABC implement the same protocol, right?
But like, how do they know each other's IP addresses?
Oh, they don't have to, because one. So D will find. So the D, right? D is a person.
Yeah.
He serves a net. He happens to find app, right?
Happen to find app.
Yeah, he happens to find app or happens to find the server. He is serving web, because this entire network is running on top of the internet, right? So C, A, B, A, B, and C has a certain kind of host, right? It's like Google.com. So A is Google, C is Facebook, and you know, oh shit, amazing alone. But at, you know, and you know, so D, yeah. So each of them has a host name, right? So D is serving the net, and he stumbled upon, you know, Facebook.com. Well, he thought, oh, I like F, so I'm gonna follow F. So the moment he follow F, you know, he tell his server, hey,
oh, okay.
A, I want to follow F from server C. And that's how A will subscribe to that F guy from C. And because they implement the same protocol, A can now fetch data from C and show it to you.
How is the benefit to the servers in terms of like money, like help them on?
No, these are all volunteer. Yeah, usually these networks always volunteer run and donation run. Yeah, there's no. Yeah,
how do they sustain their computation cost?
Well, they have to pay for it. And yeah. There's really no, like there's no, in the majority, there's really not a lot of incentive. Because people, right, the goal of these people who set up these servers is so that they can share information more than trying to make a profit from the information stuff. Because, you know, right, if you try to make a profit from that, then you'll become Facebook anyway. Okay, right. So, yeah, there's not a lot of mechanism to make money on top of this. But mainly, it's a way to share data between, you know, these machines. Okay, let's move on. Decentralized. Here's a Wikipedia page if you want to read more of it. So using the same terminology that we have, a decentralized network is actually a total network with a very well-balanced CIDR ratio. Why? The reason is because a lot of these decentralized networks, they enforce you to contribute the same amount before you can even use the network itself. So, for example, right, if you are using blockchain without a service, right, that's two ways to use. There are two ways to use Bitcoin, right? One way is that you use a wallet online, which is a service, which they have a blockchain on that service that allows you to access it. So that would be a distributed system, but we will not talk about that. But in a decentralized network, assuming you want to connect to the blockchain, right? You must download the entire blockchain before you can use it, and you also have to serve it to other people too, right?
I feel like you just have these two terms reversed. The way that I typically have seen them used, at least, decentralized refers to the first one, and distributed refers to this one.
No. I've actually seen decentralized.
Well, I don't think the reason why I don't agree with that, because distributed means that you have a server though, right? In a distributed network, usually the client commits to a server, and the client actually are not setting up their own server.
No, it's just like if you look on the Wikipedia page, it should like have a picture, right? Which.
Well,
look at the centralized network.
Distributed network.
It's like the same one as you just went to.
Google has it.
There should be pictures somewhere.
I think it's just look at decentralization.
Yeah, Lewis.
On
I googled distributed memory and I got a picture. So did you Google it instead of okay. Forgo your privacy for one
second. Wow.
All right.
Okay. Look. Yeah, like one of the middle two pictures. One of the middle two pictures.
This one?
No. Right? Or yes. That.
That.
Yeah. Either of those.
Mm-hmm.
I think that clearly shows that you have them reversed.
Damn. It seems that's the case.
Wait, but in this picture that I'm looking at, it's different.
Wait, you guys.
Like there's servers and they're all like fully connected.
No,
right.
That's not good enough.
But that's like saying
like there needs to be a comparison between distributed and decentralized.
Okay.
Wait, Phil.
Stop clicking on so much stuff.
Wait,
yeah,
look at that.
Yeah,
it, this one shows that
it's the same thing. That's what I'm saying.
Oh yeah, it is. Yeah, it's surprising.
See, decentralized just means that there's no, you know, one node in the middle, but distributed means that there are no nodes with a very high degree.
TIL.
What? But then, so would it be that the Mastodon and whatnot?
Yes, those are decentralized, and the ones that you really want to talk about, I believe, are more fully distributed.
You like Bitcoin fully distributed?
This
not really
question.
In theory. Well, in theory, yes, but not really.
Hmm.
Like, there are different degrees. It's a matter
of...
Are you
going to cover, like, mining? And
mining's, like, anyone
either.
Can join it, but...
Well, yeah, like,
it's
I was
not,
just thinking
it's
of
more
that picture.
It's not distributed.
Is that kind of picture, it tells you...
Yeah, it's the exact picture that I drew up here.
So I think you just have those terms backwards.
Oh, all right. Well, let's finish. Let's continue with the talk.
It's just important to be consistent.
Yep. One of the things though is the reason why I thought this was the case or this how the graph looked like is because when I use the Neboli stuff, I thought that how it looked like because in Mastodon or in Frenica, it was a group would set a server, so other people join the server. So it felt to me that it would be like the client would join a certain server and then the server can talk to each other, which would more look like that graph. In a decentralized network, you have that concept of peer-to-peer in which you would get data from other people and then use it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So like you always have to share the same amount of data with the other guy or with your peer. So it looked to me, that's the thing though, one thing that I felt like that is kind of confusing is maybe could it be distributed networking and distributed network? The networking of it?
Well, that's...
You know, I just saw a sentence. Decentralized means that there is no single point where the decision is made.
Mm-hmm.
Distributed means that the processing is shared across multiple nodes.
Right, so like distributed would be like a subset of decentralized, where
mm-hmm.
it's like a stronger condition than decentralized. You know what I mean?
Interesting.
All right,
we can continue the talk.
Yeah, anyway, I can just reverse it. Yeah, that's nothing.
Just continue.
Anyway, so, go back to... So, the component of decentralized protocol. So here are all the components. I just ripped this off from the DAT protocol paper. So, if you want to look more of them, then click it too. But the two main components that I always kind of like think about is basically, you always want to have a handshake, and you always want to have so handshake data and feed are kind of the two main components of this decentralized protocol. And while it's pretty self-explanatory, with the feed, you can basically grab data from the protocol. With the handshake, you can now tell two clients to connect to each other through the protocol. And with data is what you send through the protocol. Synchronize the Git repository from your website, from your machine itself. And then right on top of what they have. So it allows you basically in this case when they shape that you can turn any folder into a DAT. which is into basically a Git repository that you can share, you know, your file, you know, the version of your file. And people can actually track through the history of your file and take a look at it, which is pretty interesting. That's how they do a, you can do a bunch of interesting property of that.
So,
and
so is that kind of similar to IPFS?
Yes. It is
cool.
Very similar, but it's free. And there may be something else. There's some other stuff. Well, the API stuff, that's one thing I want to say.
The API
you don't like the IPFS API?
No, the DAT.
Or the DAT? Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Well, they're improving it, and also they are more, they're trying to make it so that IPFS, the main hurdle IPFS that I have now is you still need a, when I didn't talk about sound on IPFS today.
Yeah.
And then the main hurdle was the freaking build for the client side. It was pretty crappy back then. With that though, they're trying to rebuild it so that you can actually use a, you can actually have a virtual file system on top of your browser now.
Ooh, nice.
With random memory access. They made that module called memory. So search for random memory access is the entire module to make a virtual file system on top of your browser. So that you can have a working, you know, a working DAP on top of your normal browser.
Oh, cool.
So it's like, yeah. I don't know, but well, anyway, next. So our next social media. Well, they call themselves decentralized. So that's why. Oh, tell me nothing. But yeah, decentralized here is Rotondo, and here's a web. Here's a link. So Rotondo. Anyway, it's a peer-to-peer decentralized social media on top of the DAP protocol. The way they do this is every single time you tweet something, it becomes a Git comment. You commit a Git message on top to your DAP tab archive, and you send it, you know, and you host it online. And then when you online, other people can discover you, and they can synchronize from your Git archive, and then based on the timeline on the Git timeline or not. I'm using Git because you probably know it, but it's not Git though. The title is totally different, but it has the same tab. You know, it has everything for the versioning system. So like, you know, the commit hash, right, and then timeline, and then message itself, in the payload. So if you want to read more about that, right, then I'll read. Then you can take a look at that protocol. The paper is on top of that, and it describes the entire protocol with every single component here, with every single payload. That you know, if you want to re-implement it, or you know, just use it. Just use the library. They have been working hard at it. Now, the cool thing about this protocol, right? The cool thing about this project is everything is globally stored. So you basically synchronize. If you're following 10 people, for example, you basically are calling 10 different repository into your machine, and you basically, and then the client is basically have to sort those information. So you have a Twitter feed, you know, using Git. Kind of cool, right? Hey, maybe we implement that with Git. Huh? Try that. Then, yeah. So the way the system works is sort of following mechanism, which is basically cloning. So when you follow someone, you say, hey, I want to, you know, follow that Git archive. So every time you open this web app, it will literally just go through your every single DAP archive that you want to subscribe to and just reclone them or just like update them. And that's how it works internally. And it's actually, I think this project made in about a weekend or something, a week, by one of the guy. A guy named Neuronet?
Devin.
Kevin?
Yeah,
Devin.
Name, right?
That's his real name, Devin, but I use his handle name. And the guy is now, he's selling out. He's came from Canada, and he's now just, he's on a boat with his girl, with his wife, I think, and they just travel all over the place on the boat and make a game. Can you believe that? He just travel on the boat making Sony. Yeah, the game has an art. So it's like black and white art. That's what I was talking about, anyway. But yeah, the game has these type of black and white art with this. With weird symbol and shit, and I kid you not, the guy he just posted on the computer two weeks ago, and he was making a freaking terminal to make music, so the programming language to make music on a terminal. And I'm like, this guy is insane, but he's pretty cool. Take a look at him and take a look at his project. He has a lot of stuff, but I think he's more of an artist than a coder, because I think a lot of his code kind of smell, maybe. The main problem with this project is that you need a specialized browser called Beaker browser. Yes.
What about HyperProxy?
Yeah, maybe we did the same, right? We did.
Yeah.
We managed the same. So HyperProxy is the project that Seth and I was working on that allow you to access that protocol by, you know, by the proxy. The proxy is pretty much a server that we host.
So it's like you can do it like.
This goes through you guys.
You can
no,
like
not,
JavaScript.
Not really.
So you don't need to have a specialized browser.
Yeah, but not really going through us. You're going through a bot that's spawned by us. So technically, if the bot was spawned by someone else and not our server, it's the same thing. So it's, you know, it just, so.
So it's literally a proxy.
It's a peer-to-peer proxy. Yeah.
It's a peer-to-peer proxy though.
Okay.
So imagine, right, if right now all the proxy itself is handling the request, but what if the proxy itself is asking a peer to handle the request? Yeah.
So like the proxy is just a tracker, and then people can volunteer their computers or whatever to proxy traffic from vanilla JavaScript via WebSockets to actual sockets.
Yep.
Yeah.
So it's like a bridge.
Exactly.
Yeah. Exactly.
We mirror the infrastructure using the WebRTC. The WebTorrent protocol.
Ooh, nice.
WebTorrent used to have the same problem where their native client and their browser client cannot talk to each other because they have the same problem. They are not talking in the same, you know, because the browser client has a lot of restriction. So what they did was they made the exact same thing called WebTorrent Hybrid that basically act as a proxy that when a client from the browser trying to get some file from a pool basically, then some hybrid client, you know, that are both running browser and also torrent node can voluntarily grab that and return the request. So that's how you now have a lot of streaming, you know, like torrent streaming side now, you know, so you're welcome. I did not make that though, but I mean, you should take a look, it's very interesting. Yeah, and you know what, because the usage of this Rotondo is mainly synchronizing on your pulling from a lot of Git repo, it's very slow. But if you subscribe to about 100 people, it gets slow real quick. And yeah, every time you start up, and people post stuff, right? You have to synchronize, you have to pull up, and the way it sucks, so yeah. It's a cool project though, so hopefully it will. And it's actually one of the more interesting design social media out there, so, you know. And the next protocol is Scuttlebutt. Ooh, Scuttlebutt, what is it? Well, it has the same component as any decentralized protocol, decentralized protocol, very similar to that protocol. The one thing that it doesn't do though, it doesn't versioning stuff. So it is a kind of like a, it's like, it learned from DAD, but it doesn't want to. So DAD was made to become more of an archive system, right? They want everything to be versioned. They want an internet that has versioning. That's why they have sponsor from the Internet Archive, you know, so that they can, they can archive shit. I think that's just fine too, but they, you know, they're trying to make the file call shit. That's why people are so,
You're the one that did not understand what
you said. Oh, I mean, Filecoin is fine, but then they have that IPFS is fine, but then they have that Filecoin initiative that people like are.
There's like a whole sort of penumbra of like projects around IPFS which never seem to really work.
Yep.
Yeah.
Because
it's kind of disappointing.
The client side API is usual, but then it sucks and it was depending on WebRTC?
And like I tried to set up like a IPNS, like register,
name server,
an IPFS
DNS
domain or something.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And, but it like I looked everywhere and it's like there's like oh yeah use IPNS and I looked everywhere but there's nothing you can actually it's like vaporware at this point.
Yeah.
You can't actually use it.
The API right. changes all the time and it deprecates and like they. Instead of like supporting the previous API, they just completely like.
It's not even an alpha stage at this point. It's like pre-alpha.
Oh, right.
I mean, it was.
Oh, I guess that's why. Yeah, that makes sense.
I mean, he assuming that.
I don't want to finish your sentence. You're probably going to say this, but Scuttlebutt is less about archiving and more about just like gossip.
Yeah,
right.
It's literally a gossip network.
That's their whole like.
That's
shit.
The first sentence they have on the header. But yeah, want to read more about this protocol? It's not kind of a protocol. How it work? Well,
they have this whole thing where it's like they want the architecture of the network to mimic real-world social networks where, you know, people,
yeah.
you know, word of mouth stuff.
Exactly. So you only
like,
subscribe to the person you meet, you know.
On the one hand, it's an interesting concept, but on the other hand, it's like, is that really better?
We never know, but we'll see. But basically, to talk about the Gaussian infrastructure, you have the new user, you're the new user, and there's a pub. What's a pub? A pub is a public user that is available for everyone to subscribe to. And it could be like a server. And it literally is a server. Usually it's a server. It's a bot. It's very similar to the hybrid that we have, the WebRTC hybrid. That basically is a bridge that allows you to join a network. And so when you join a pub, you can contact with other people. And then if the pub no other user, you now join a larger network. So that's basically how it works. And assuming that the pub is clean and it's not one just a silly bot, or if the pub is well maintained, then you can actually have a bunch of, you know, you can talk to a lot of cool people on top of that. Yeah, so here's a link to the protocol. You decentralize, it's function offline, and that's a cool part about that. You can do everything social media offline, and then when you go online, it will synchronize to your network. It is a mesh net system. I think they have plans to implement a bunch of, like,
what if you change something and when you get back online, the state of the network has already changed. So who do they accept?
Oh, yes, it is everything.
Like a merge conflict.
Yeah.
What happens? Well, like you can do something like bad too. Like you can pretty much edit somebody's post while you're offline, and then when you're trying.
You would need their private key to make a signature, so you couldn't do that.
Oh, okay.
You couldn't edit someone's post.
So you'll have access to yours.
Yeah, and the reason why is because of cryptography.
It is signed by the original poster.
Yeah, so everything is signed.
Oh, I see. It's from New Zealand. That's why it's weird.
He's got, maybe. Basically, right, I don't think there'll be conflict, right? Because message are unique per user, and then the key are unique per user.
You could, I guess. Oh, no, never mind.
I mean, even different devices will probably generate different hash per message. And then the timestamp is probably, you know, also contributing to a factor or two. And then it's a social media, right? So it's not really changing the same code, but you're more adding onto it than editing stuff. I suppose if you need to edit something, they need to be online. But then the moment you submit your edit to a certain thing, you have to be online, you have to.
Maybe it's just a fan only.
It do allow you to edit stuff though. Even a fan only, I think that also now has. Yeah, that doesn't have overriding. It does allow you to prune the stuff though. You can actually prune history in that. So
that's cool. How? That's weird.
Oh, because you control the files and you just prune it and tell people, hey, here's the latest version. And everyone can just clone it, right?
Oh.
I mean, if they made a copy of your stuff before they clone it, then yeah, they didn't have access to it.
Right.
But, well, yeah, and, well, what's the problem with this network? It's super slow. Yep, that's expected. Because, you know, as any decentralized network, you have to synchronize up every single one.
Yeah. There's actually a phone, there's like an Android app called Matter? No.
Mattermost?
No. That can't be it.
Well, it does have a mobile client. He made it. So the way he did it, he actually ported his entire Scuttlebutt protocol into another Android client. He has a giant roadmap. I'm talking about this guy. This is Andres. He has a giant roadmap to make a social media on top of mobile. And
it's called Miniverse. Sorry, like Miniverse.
Was it the same thing? Was it made by this guy? Was it made by
Mini?
Was
by a lot.
Was it made by Andres?
I don't know, probably.
If it's that guy, then that's probably the thing. But yeah, it's an entire roadmap to actually, so in terms of the mobile side of this project, the Scuttlebutt protocol has been ported to Android into like some kind of a usable binary and exposed as a React Native component. Mm-hmm. So you can actually, if you can make a React Native app, you can actually install this component and make an app that runs on top of this Scuttlebutt protocol.
It says it was made by Andre Stoltz.
Yeah, that's a god right there. Yeah, he may be god though. I mean, even Dan, you know, retweeted him. So
Dan,
Yeah.
Abramov?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I guess.
Anyway, and then the other thing, you need special software to access the protocol. This protocol is not even, I don't think they even care about trying to integrate that to Chrome browser or any browser, unlike DAD. DAD is trying hard to get themselves into Firefox now, and mm-hmm. hopefully they can be, you can think of DAD as like HTTPS or HTTP or, you know, TCP, UDP, or, oh, no, not TCP, HTTP, more of a, you know, the accessing protocol.
Application layer.
I find it disheartening that like people can't like just, you know, run random software on their own devices, because you always have to get it from, you know, like the Apple Store or the Play Store or whatever.
Yeah.
And like you can just, you know, get it through other channels, but it don't make it easy to do that per se.
Well, if you want to,
Everybody has a browser, so it's like they want everything to be through the browser, but browsers are based around a certain assumption about the network architecture, and it doesn't always work very well.
Yeah, well, I mean, the reason for security, right? That's basically the main reason.
I mean, yes, for security purposes, usually most users, you know, just downloading and executing random apps is probably not a good idea, but...
It's also for money.
But it's like, are you protecting the users from themselves?
Yeah.
Or are you protecting them from, you know, that's the question.
Protecting them from themselves.
I think it's protecting them from themselves because most people have no idea. Like, my dad has, like, well, he had, I got rid of them, but, like, 30, like, adware apps on his Android phone because, yeah.
I think what we should allow for is somewhere deep in the, you know, developer settings of a phone, you can choose, okay, to make advanced options. For example, if a certain button does something, it'll allow you, if you get into that setting, allow you to change it. So as long as...
But it's just like he said, though, that like even from the Play Store, you get, you know, hundreds and thousands of just crappy apps, which aren't like, you know, like they're not outright malware.
Yeah,
but it's like, you know, this the Candy Crush and the, you know, whatever.
The Candy Crush is a legitimate
stuff.
Application.
So I got rid of all those ads.
System disk cleaner or whatever.
And I installed Brave browser on my dad's phone.
Oh.
No ads anymore, and no apps. It's amazing, like because it has an ad blocker.
Yeah,
that's
cool. Brave browser and the AT coin. How's the AT coin going? Huh? What is it? Is that Action Coin or something? ABT.
You're missing some emoji there.
Oh yeah, I mean the emoji is dead.
You got tofu.
Yeah. Anyway, so yeah, you can see that, right? Here's a conclusion that I think that I made. That
just
I made this.
Great emoji.
So next gen is available. It's out there. You can use it.
I feel like Mastodon gives us hope because it's actually very successful.
Yeah, for the furry community.
Especially in Japan.
Yeah, that's true though. Yeah, Japan love it. They move all the Twitter shit over to Mastodon. For some reason. I don't know. But they love it a lot. Censorship, maybe, right? A lot of the censorship problems would be fixed if we switch over to, you know, structures that are not that are harder to you know, to bomb, to attack.
Right.
Speed shit. So that's why there's hope emoji there. And then the rest. Oh, so can you get viral on this network? Maybe in the long run, maybe not. Probably not. Because for a lot of these networks, you are expected to join a certain pool, so you might not reach millions of people.
I don't know. I think
anytime
soon. I think I recently made a post on my Pleroma server, which got like 20 reposts or something.
Yeah.
Whoa.
And that's not the definition of viral, man.
It's not bad. It's not bad.
And you go viral, you get when you get a million likes. Tell me.
Okay.
I'll be. I was like, oh yeah, that's what it is. Well, privacy is also a concern.
Oh, yeah, see, 21 reboosts.
Wow.
Hey, you know the video that I posted on Facebook like a week ago? It got 2,000 views now. 2,000 views. We actually got nice share and what recommend on different groups. So maybe shout out to Facebook for that. Anyway, privacy is another problem, right? Well, at least a lot of these networks you own them. Some of the network own data, some of the network maybe not, because, you know, the server stuff on the data.
To me, that's, like, the most important one, personally.
Privacy?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, two per curly sub under the closet, right? And then is this, are they future proof? Well, yeah, when they viral, I'll say they future proof. Cost? Yeah, a lot of them. You have to brand yourself, right? A lot of this community has to spend the money, spend server money to host the server, for the join. So the cost, maybe, right? Eventually, hopefully, the hope is the taxpayer might actually pay for this. Maybe, I don't know.
No, why that?
Then you have, I mean, talking about free.
That's interesting.
Free social media. Come on, man. I mean,
it's not free, because the taxpayers paying for it.
Well, okay, but it's a public
good. No, the cost.
It's a public good.
It's a public thing.
Well,
it's a library, right? So, instead of like paying tax to maintain a library, you can just, break the library down, someone use it, and let's host everything on that, for example. Then pay for that.
I mean, why not make it like cryptocurrency, like, so every time you...
Hey, I make a fund, right? Pay for that.
What were you saying?
Okay, so every time you... host data, every time you're being a seed, you get some kind of coin, and then every time you be a leader, you give some kind of coin.
That's a concept besides iPod, But then, the problem is, right, does people want that? Would it even make more money than this app, It's just a thing.
So it can, maintain the economic side, because otherwise there wouldn't be any incentive to host it.
No, that's the thing, though. There's actually a trial where they test that versus the... So there's a thing called... What's it? Another currency that based on five hosting. I forgot the name of it. But
Made Safe is one of them, I believe.
And then there's another one, Web something. It has the interface ready. But basically, if you look at some of the website that for file sharing, for example, MegaShare. Is it now MegaShare now or something else?
Does MegaShare still up? They exist.
There's something else called Mega something, right?
Mega.nz.
Yeah, Mega.nz.
It used to be called Mega Upload, and now the government's no thanks, and now they're Mega Upload.
Mega never works for me. There's a link to Mega, I try to download it, and it's your download will begin in 3 hours.
You need to register for it, but...
No, you gotta pay for the...
But the point is, the point is to ask the question, so that one is using a subscription base, and they make money, and then you have, Mega... all the other sharing system, where they mainly just show ad, and it worked well. And a lot of them are free too.
That's the thing. Someone is always paying the cost. It's just a question of how do you create either reduce the cost so much that it, costs basically nothing and people will just run it because, they're altruistic and it's I'm paying $5 a month. It's not that much.
I think they should get rewarded for money.
What about Google Drive? I guess Google makes their money from ads.
Well,
there can be a variety. There can be a diversity of different
Definitely. Models. No, I'm just the process of using ads. You just
pulls ads to create the infrastructure and maintain the infrastructure.
Yeah.
But you're not gonna I feel if you do Filecoin and stuff, mm-hmm. then people using this network will have to pay for both the internet and then now also accessing websites. I feel for people that are disenfranchised and stuff, that will really limit what you can do on the internet.
I mean, the thing is, when you host something, you also get paid for hosting.
What do you mean?
You can access the file and pay. Pay coins to access the file, we can host it, and then have somebody who accesses the file from you to be a seed. When you send someone a file, they send you coins.
It's very hard to enforce money on that. Imagine if you're the only guy who's hosting the file, anyone can DDoS you and send you out. If they want to censor you, right? So you have to maintain that. So
the thing is, to have a large user base.
So now if you have a large, let's say you have a large user base, a lot of people seeding, right? Then why would they give you money, right? Everyone who seeds should get the money, right?
I mean, no.
But if the network is too big, then the money will spread out.
So the person will have his own algorithm selecting who to download the file from, and then it'll all be distributed to the random. So we kind of like a normal distribution, it will be randomly distributed, and in the long term, you will get just as much money as the other person who's seen it, who's seen in the same file.
You can definitely implement that structure on top of Bitcoin.
Yeah.
Because when you send a certain next transaction from a person to another person, you also send him a little bit of money.
Yeah.
So
I'm saying
that can be done too. And actually, I did that for I made a project. I made a project called WebRTC Ethereum that allow you to. So it's not sending money, but it's sending data. So you send data to another person using a transaction, you know, using the payload. There's a small, yeah. Besides, so in a transaction, there's a small snippet that allow you to post some data, return data into that.
Or you can have like when you send something, you have to process two other persons thing, kind of.
But like there are also, I've seen recently that there have been people that are like they're embedding the social media data directly into, like, in this case I've seen them on the Bitcoin Cash blockchain, because Bitcoin Cash is the one that I follow most closely. They could be on other ones, but there are projects like memo.cash and yours.org, which I think switch to Bitcoin SV, but let's not talk
really
about that
they
right
did?
Now.
That's so sad.
But essentially what they're doing is like they're embedding their like data for their feed into just an op return, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they're, you know, just putting data like posts and, you know, responses and likes and stuff into transactions.
That
and,
sounds
like,
really gross.
So like, yeah, I don't really like it that much, but like, it makes sense kind of, because like you have one censorship resistant, you know, system that's proven to work already.
Are they hashing it all, or are they like, is it just literally just plain text?
Like if you want everybody to see that like you posted, I went to the beach today. You make a transaction where the op return plain text is,
yeah.
I went to the beach today. Some special tag that like says this is a memo post or whatever.
Oh my god, that's a lot of data.
Yeah, it's a lot of data, because you have to also send the keys.
It's not scalable.
I mean, if the miners are willing to mine it, then that's their choice, but...
You know what, the problem
is... It's not scalable, no.
Yeah. The problem is a lot of
I mean, a better thing, and this is easy, just to have the hash and then a tag, and then give the actual content that will hash to that.
The data still has to be hosted somewhere.
Yes,
like,
right.
It has to be hosted, embedded somewhere.
Right.
Anyway, that's it. That's the talk.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Very nice talk.